strongly over a period of months, and they asked me to get one of them, and my first inclination was to do the exopayments, which was what we were involved in looking for. It was sort of, but Alan Gilmore had grabbed that one before me, so I decided to talk about this. So originally gave it on the radio, but a lot of it's happened since that time. So you know, there was a time in the universe where there were no stars, and at the moment it's still an unsolved problem as how the first stars actually got going. So it's not the end of the story by any means. But so what I'm going to talk about is, you know, what these stars could be like, how they could have formed, and you know, how we could detect them. So in order to understand what's different about time when the first stars formed and time now, I'll talk about how they form today. The cosmic dark ages was a time when the universe was completely dark and nothing much was happening, but the stars formed at the end of that time. We'll talk about the first stars and then detecting them. So star formation today. This is an interesting new image of the Milky Way galaxy. They had to go quite a long way to take this. It's actually done by radio astronomers who map the hydrogen of the galaxy. But I'm not too interested in defined detail, except it's a great picture. But it shows a couple of things. One is that in our galaxy today, stars are forming. These are star-forming regions where all the pinky stuff is around there, and then the spiral arms. The impression you have of a galaxy is that you know, these are dense areas where the stars are forming. That's not so. In fact, if you looked at the disk of the Milky Way galaxy, it would be very flat, very uniform everywhere. But you get these bands of star formation. And that's simply caused by pressure waves, essentially, that are rippling around in the plane of the galaxy. So called kinematic waves. And as these waves pass through, it takes millions of years for them to pass through, they compress the gas, create some instabilities in the clouds of gas and dust, and trigger star formation. Then they pass through. So these areas in between are simply areas where the stars are a bit older. These are where the stars are younger and brighter, and so it gives you that impression that these are like sort of like a Catherine wheel. It's not like that at all. But also, I'll draw your attention to the fact that the Milky Way's got about 150-odd globular clusters. Some haven't been discovered yet, but it's in that order. You probably have seen them all through a lot of them through telescopes. These are massive clusters. The Milky Way doesn't produce anymore, so globular clusters are a fossil record of the early star formation of the Milky Way. Some of these, I mean, I think there's about 600 around the Andromeda galaxy, and there's other big galaxies as well that have thousands and thousands of globular clusters, but they're Milky Way doesn't form them anymore, so all our globular clusters are old stars. But today in the Milky Way, basically star formation takes place in giant molecular clouds like this. You don't find stars just coming into existence in the middle of nowhere. They form in large clumps over a relatively short time span of a few million years once the cloud starts to collapse. And there's been a lot of research done on these giant molecular clouds, and this is a Hubble picture. So basically stars form within these. They don't form out here in the middle of sort of empty areas. They form inside clouds, and these clouds provide a nursery, a protection. They're actually using the term nursery quite often to describe these things, because that's where they form today. And eventually, if you go back and look at one of these places after maybe 10 million years, you'll see something like this. This is the Jewel Box Cluster near Crookes. So these stars here, this is one of the youngest of the Milky Way's open clusters. A few thousand stars there. They formed within the last 10 million years. And they're still hanging together. But if you come back and look at this in another sort of 100 million years, those stars will have spread out a lot, and if you look at it in 500 million years, you won't even know there's a cluster there. You'd actually have to measure a whole lot of stars, wind time backwards, and find they all came from a common place to know they're actually related to each other. they'd also be formed essentially out of the same material, so they, their chemistry would be virtually identical. The only thing that changes from one star to another in a cluster essentially is how much mass it's got. So that's a very important thing. It's very important to our understanding of how stars evolve, because we've got lots of test beds of these sort of clusters where the only difference between the stars and the cluster is their masses, or whether they're binary. That's another factor. And if you look at the vicinity of our own, this is a new map done by radio telescopes, showing basically the distribution of hydrogen and dust, but basically there's the sun, and these are all the basically clouds of hydrogen and dusty clumps, all just within our sort of immediate vicinity. There's the Pleiades there, which is about 430 light years from the sun, so that gives you an idea of the scale. So the Milky Way is a very busy place, and this is just in our backyard. And any of these could, some of them have already produced star clusters, like the Pleiades, of course. Others are sitting there and they're waiting to eventually collapse and form a new cluster of stars. It's not always clear what triggers the collapse, I might say. Sometimes it's because of vicinity and a supernova and roughly in the vicinity, and the shockwave of that supernova destabilizes these big cold clouds of dust and gas and triggers a collapse. That's the sort of, it's sort of a random process. And the thing that actually makes this all work and makes it work today in our galaxy is the presence of dust. And these are just some micrographs of cosmic dust. They are, you've got the basic elements. Oh, you've got hydrogen and helium gas, they're all mixed up together. That all came from the Big Bang, and then you've got this dust stuff, which is made of elements heavier than hydrogen and helium, carbon, iron, all sorts of heavier elements. These are all synthesized by stars, so without sort of star formation and supernovae, you don't get dust. And but dust today plays a very important role in regulating and allowing star formation to even happen. The mechanism by which it works is shown here, where stars are spewing out huge amounts of ultraviolet radiation. Some stars are more prodigious than others, but certain big hot stars produce huge amounts of ultraviolet. Ultraviolet heats the local environment and basically stops stuff from wanting to clump. It gets the kinetic energy in the gas is too great. So in order to get star formation, you have to have some way to get rid of that energy, and this is what dust grains do. So a dust grain like this, which would have billions and trillions of atoms in it with chemical bonds, when it gets hit by a photon, the energy of that photon, UV photon, gets distributed over vast numbers of bonds and structures within that one micron body, and it keeps taking that grain keeps taking these hits over time until it gradually warms up, that all that energy distributed over there warms up until it releases a infrared photon. So the infrared photons have the property, they're much longer wavelength, so they can actually go right through dust clouds without stopping. They don't see dust clouds essentially. So basically what's happening is that the dust, the ultraviolet energy of nearby stars is being processed by dust, released as released entirely from the cloud by infrared photons, and that therefore drops the temperature of the cloud. So gradually it's a way that the cloud has of losing energy, siphoning it off, and if it wasn't for dust, that wouldn't happen. If you just had a cloud of hydrogen helium gas, that process wouldn't work. But this is today, in the modern universe, in the current universe, that's basically the process by which these vast clouds of dust and gas can collapse. Take away the dust, it won't work. So, what a simple process. So these molecular clouds in the Milky Way today typically have 10 to 1,000 solar masses, maybe more. Just some ideas. I mean, that sounds like a lot of molecules per cubic centimeter. It's not. It's better than a vacuum you can make on Earth. So it's not very particularly dense, but they're just huge. So So the molecules are protected from UV by the dust. The clouds get really cold, down to 10 to 50 degrees above absolute zero, as the heat's radiated away. And then the local collapse of that cloud can be triggered by either little density variations, so the cloud isn't just a uniform thing, you can have areas of more dense material than others, and those areas will could collapse just under gravity slowly, or probably more likely it's going to get to some shockwave from a nearby supernova, it's going to go off, basically rattle and shake up the system and trigger collapse. So there's the conundrum we've got. The dust grains are required for star formation. Can't take them away. They're made of elements that are heavier than helium. That's stuff made from stars. These all come from stars, the deaths of throes of stars, mainly supernovae. So how did the first stars get going? It's a bootstrap problem, as mathematicians have talked about. So that's been the difficulty. The other difficulty, of course, is the part of the universe where the first stars in the universe were forming is very hard to see. But we're starting to develop methods by which you can actually probe and look deeper into the universe than we've ever been able to do before. So that's the problem we're trying to address. So we talk about the cosmic dark ages, which is now the Big Bang. Actually, within a really short time, after about 15 minutes after the Big Bang, the universe was still about a billion degrees in temperature, after that 15 minutes, 90%, the universe ended up 90%, or the atoms in the universe, 90% hydrogen and 10% helium nuclei. At this stage, it's way too hot to hold on to electrons, so these are just the sort of protons, and two protons, two neutrons being the helium nuclei. So those are the only atoms. There were trace amounts of deuterium and lithium produced as well, but they're not. Those are like one part in a million compared with the others, and none of the atoms could hold on to the electrons at that sort of temperature. So after 15 minutes after the Big Bang, we had hydrogen and helium nuclei sitting there in a really hot environment, and all that happened for the next hundreds of thousand years as the universe expanded and slowly cooled. And so the next sort of epoch that you get to is after about 380,000 years. That's a reasonably robust number nowadays. The universe had expanded enough and cooled down. It got down to 3,000 degrees Celsius, roughly. That's about half the temperature of the sun's surface. And at that temperature, hydrogen and helium can hold on to their electrons. So all of a sudden, these bare nuclei floating around, paired up with electrons, and in a very short order, the universe became neutral. So we ended up with a neutral star. Now the thing about that is that once you've got neutral atoms, then photons can just travel through the universe without being interrupted by charged particles. So basically, that the universe became essentially transparent. This is a picture taken by the Planck satellite, which was looking in the. Because this radiation here is coming to us today in the microwave wavelength, so it's detected by the cosmic microwave background satellites. The first one was COBE and so on. Shows the over and under density parts. So this is a map of the entire sky, but it's been wrapped around so you can see it on the plane. A lot of work goes into trying to figure out and decode all the sort of the distribution of density that you got, but it seems to be basically a completely random process. Now at this stage, at 380,000 years, that corresponds to a redshift of about 1100. That means the universe today has expanded about 1100 times in size since that radiation was released. And so it was free to those photons were just free to travel through the universe, and the universe continued to cool. So 3,000 degrees Celsius enabled neutral atoms to form, and then again nothing happened for another few hundred million years. So in this cartoon basically shows us, so where we're basically up to is here, so the era of recombination where the temperature's dropped to 3,000 degrees in the universe and the atoms have combined with the free electrons, and the universe, the material, the atoms in the universe have become neutral. And so basically through this period, all that's happening is the universe is cooling and expanding. There's nothing else really going on there. But looking back from our time back here, when we look back and want to see, we can see these nearby galaxies like Andromeda and the Virgo cluster and all those sort of things. They are relatively mature and understood. But as we look further and further back with the modern telescopes, the galaxies end up looking sort of scruffy little dwarf things. So they're not like, we don't see the mature spirals like the Milky Way back then. The Milky Way is the result of the mergers of probably thousands of dwarf galaxies over the last sort of 12 billion years. So, and it's still a process going on. I think we know about four or five, at least, dwarf galaxies currently been identified that are currently being absorbed by the Milky Way, and there'll be more to come in the future. In fact, one day, of course, the Milky Way will merge with the Andromeda galaxy in about 4 or 5 billion years. So basically, if you look back, you gradually see more and more primitive galaxies, smaller and smaller ones. They're all dwarfs. You don't see large galaxies back at this sort of time. But basically, looking backwards in time, the furthest you can look back at the moment, the Hubble has probably got the record for that at the present time, it's to a time about 400 million years after the Big Bang. So you're down back about here somewhere. They can detect dwarf galaxies that and they can, because of the redshift, you can tell that they're around about the 400 million years. So that's so at the moment we can't look back far enough to see the stars, but we can at least look back and see sort of the first primitive galaxies that we know contain stars. But in future we'll be able to look back further than that, but that's the limit at the present time. So basically, this whole area here has been sort of inaccessible for study. The other important thing that's happened since when the universe, at the time of the Big Bang, when by the time atoms were formed, basically it came in with about, so it's got this extra stuff called dark matter, which is, we know the universe has got dark matter, but nobody really knows fundamentally what it is. Or what its real properties are, except that it feels gravity and doesn't seem to feel electromagnetic force. So it shouldn't interact, in principle, shouldn't be interacting with atoms in any way except through gravity. That's still an open question, really. So basically the ratio between dark matter and atoms is about 5 to 1, so there's about 5 times more mass in the universe of dark matter than atoms. If you run forward the clock to today, then you'll see there's a great big chunk here now called dark energy, which is, it seems to be a energy associated with the vacuum of space in some obscure way. But if it's not there, the universe doesn't make any sense at all. So it's there, and there's a lot of theorists trying to figure out all the details. But again, the ratio between atoms and dark matter is still the same. All that's happened is the energy budget of the universe is changed in the sense that it's now, most of it is this mysterious dark energy. So, so all through this time then, the amount as the universe expanded, so for every cubic light year of universe that gets added as the universe is expanding, it comes in with a bunch of dark energy. So as the universe expands, more and more dark energy is being added to the universe, and that will continue into the future. And it's actually causing the universe to sort of basically accelerate in its expansion. But then in the case here where you don't even have it, so dark matter is important. So in here there's a transition, so dark energy is increasing in this diagram. I don't have one for this particular point here where the first stars start to form, but you can see that there would have been increasing amounts of dark energy, not as much as today. And dark matter has an effect that sort of this is done on a computer simulation, so basically you can write down all the equations of, you know, the sort of gravity, feed them all into computer models and run them for months and months and months on supercomputer arrays, and you can compute, you know, basically trial universes. If you don't have dark matter that's present, and dark matter, say, only feels the gravitational force, but there's a lot of it, so as it slowly contracts, it forms more and more condensed structures, and it carries along with it the primordial hydrogen and helium gas. So that gradually gets all squished together into tighter and tighter bundles. But the difference is that there's a limit to dark matter. It can't get colder, because cooling means getting rid of photons, getting rid of energy like that, and dark matter has no way to do that. So dark matter doesn't cool in the same way as ordinary matter does. So basically, though, it provides a nursery, if you like, for ordinary matter, hydrogen and helium, but eventually it gets to the point where these big clumps of gas are able to radiate away photons and cool off enough to collapse even further. So they collapse a lot more than the dark matter does. And in fact, you can end up with, that seems to be enough to actually form stars in galaxies. But, you know, it's still a lot of unclear details in that whole story. This picture here basically shows the way in which dark matter and ordinary matter separate. So if you run, originally the ordinary matter and the dark matter are inextricably mixed, but over time the ordinary matter separates from the dark matter. I mean, it's held and contained by dark matter, but basically it separates and collapses down more. So that sort of separation process that allows you to ordinary matter, hydrogen, helium, to collapse and down and just form clumps that potentially could form stars. The other thing is that there's these hydrogen can form a molecule, hydrogen 2, hydrogen molecules, just two hydrogens joined together, and these do a very bad job of replicating what dust can do. So hydrogen molecule is tiny, tiny compared with a dust grain, but it still has the capability of absorbing photons and reprocessing sort of higher energy light. Nowhere near as efficiently as dust, but it still, if you've got enough of it, then it does provide a sort of cooling process. But dark matter has no such capability of doing that. So it's thought that hydrogen 2 molecules within big clouds of hydrogen and helium provide a sort of a cooling mechanism that does a crude approximation of what dust does today. Brings us to the first star. So sometime in the universe, the first star would have formed. It's still hazy about what it would look like, but basically once it does form, then it starts to ionize, spewing out a lot of ultraviolet light, and that would be ionizing all the surrounding gas as well. And so the light travelling away from the first stars would have been travelling at the speed of light, so it takes a long time for the whole universe to in fact make enough stars and for enough time for these bubbles to expand until they all coalesce and the whole universe is completely ionised. So all the gas in the universe is ionised, like it is now. I mean, potentially all the gas between galaxies and inside galaxies, the free stuff is ionised to not quite 100%, but it's nearly all ionized. So the universe underwent a transition from being neutral with neutral atoms, with each nuclei is bonded with tied up with its electrons, so it's neutral, until eventually they're all separated off. You had stars forming, producing a lot of energy through nuclear processes, and that led to the complete ionization of the universe. So that they've got a pretty reasonable handle on the length of time that it took. So the first stars, well, it's generally thought that the first stars that formed were large. The whole reason for that, one is that it's hard to conceive of an environment where you could actually make small stars like the Sun, but very large stars like this, gravity plays a very strong role, and once you get a collapse starting, then you can form a large star, maybe between 8 and 130 times the mass of the Sun, then a star like that will live for only a few million years and then explode as a type 2 supernova, what we call a core collapse supernova. And those happen in young stars. So that's something that massive stars do early in their life. They go bang, leave behind usually a neutron star, maybe a black hole in the center, but they blow off all their outer layers, release a huge amount of energy, and of course send shockwaves through all the local environment. So they have a profound effect on all the local environment when they do explode. Another option is to go up in mass here, up to in the range of sort of higher mass, up to sort of 130 to 250 times the mass of the Sun, then you can get what I call pair instability supernovae. That's basically where you have the energy inside a star that's massive that's so great in the core that the photons are so energetic that they will suddenly go a gamma ray, can, if it's more than about a million electron volts in energy, will split into two electrons. And they aren't the same animal. So if suddenly you had a whole lot of your high energy photons in the center converting themselves into electrons, there wouldn't be enough gas pressure to withstand the collapse of that core. And so within a very short time, that core would collapse, and you'd end up with a pretty big bang. It would basically, the central core would collapse. What usually happens is then you get a rebound, material just starts falling in. So if you imagine that all of a sudden just goes collapses like a balloon, then all the stuff over the top of it, huge amount of material powered by gravity just sees, hey, there's nothing holding us up anymore, so it falls to the center. And it does that very fast. The material rushes to the center, hits the center, and then rebounds off it, and then bam, the whole thing goes flying outwards. So it's a sort of a big rebound effect. So, but the core collapse supernova is a very powerful supernova. Pair instability supernova, sorry. And there's some of these sort of events have been observed in the local universe as well, in the relatively local universe, within a billion light years or so. There's also a possibility of forming stars that are bigger than that. Now, I might mention there is actually a what's called the Eddington limit. Sir Arthur Eddington, the famous astrophysicist in the 1920s through the 1940s, one of the leading people in this field, realised that there's a choke on how big a star you could form. Well, that's, and it's basically that if you have a star that's forming and it gets up to a certain size, then the amount of energy going out of the star will counteract any material falling in and blow it away. So it reaches a natural bottleneck. That's called the Eddington limit. And it's thought to be around 100 solar masses, 120 solar masses in that range. But we already know stars that violate that. There are stars in the Large Magellanic Cloud that are clearly more massive than the Eddington limit. So there must be some sort of ways around that happening. Maybe if it's collapsing fast enough or something like that, then you can overwhelm the Eddington limit and it doesn't act as a sort of an effective way. But it is, we have observed stars today in nearby universe that have masses probably up in this sort of extreme range. Now when you have a star that massive, when it's basically, when it runs out of energy in the center, which happens pretty quickly because it's so massive, it's so hot in the interior, all the energy, all the hydrogen gets converted to helium really fast. And so therefore the core will simply implode. But it's not quite like the pair instability supernova where you get a rebound off the core. In this case here, the whole star just goes dropped and becomes a black hole. So it goes into a free fall in the center. And the star effectively blinks out of existence. Now, I know astronomers who are looking for failed supernovae, so instead of looking at galaxies and looking for a little bright one and say, yoo-hoo, another supernova, kick it off. They're looking at galaxies that have large, massive red giants. So these are sort of red supergiants. They're very bright, they're usually the brightest object in their galaxy. So they pick out all these galaxies and then go every few months, go back and image them again and see. And then now I have at least one case that I know of where one of those really luminous red stars vanished between pictures. And despite all the research with the Hubble getting the deepest images they can possibly go, they can't see any remnant there. So in other words, the implication seems to be it's one of these cases. It's what's called they call them a failed supernova. I reckon that's sort of really, that's probably the wrong term to use. They're spectacularly successful in sort of basically getting out of the universe altogether. So that's so when that happens, though, no material is injected back into the interstellar environment. So if all the early stars were like this, we probably wouldn't be here, because we're only here because stars existed long enough to create the heavy elements, spread them through the universe, and that's what we're made of. All the carbon in our bodies came from stellar explosions originally, and all the heavy elements around are rather similar. So these, we know these occur, but they kind of being the predominant way of star formation in the early universe. And so how can we sort of start trying to detect these things? Well, there's one process that friends in Australia are doing at Siding Springs. They've got a telescope called SkyMapper that simply takes wide-angle pictures and spectra. And basically what Mike Bessel and the people over there are doing is looking for stars. There's a spectrum of the sun. This is only a narrow piece of spectrum, only a few nanometers wide. So it's just a little piece of a star spectrum. You can see that the sun has got lots of spectral lines. And as you probably know, you've seen the solar spectrum with all the black lines. So what you're looking for is a star that has almost no spectral lines, because these are all caused by metals that can only have been made by earlier generations of stars. What you're looking for is a star that has none of those. And so that's... That's the mission, and there's another big team in South America at Chile that are using big telescopes. Again, the same thing, looking, sampling stars, looking for stars that have a spectrum more like this thing here. This star here, you can see, this would be a population 3 star. That's what the spectrum would look like, pretty much totally flat air. But this star here still has some little dips in it. So it wasn't quite one of the first stars in the universe to have formed. But it probably formed very early. And also it's complicated, because you could have a star that actually was one of the first stars in the universe, but in blundering around the universe, traveling around in its galaxy, it's driven through a bunch of clouds that have been polluted by much younger stars. So how much of that material sticks to the star and then shows up when you're looking at it from the outside as elements in its atmosphere,